Finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right.
There's always gonna be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. Order. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
You have activated Python's land in which I produced this black chemical called melanin.
What we did was gave a hard line in the sand between the different definitions of esoteric study and exoteric study. Playtime is over.
Yeah! Peace and love, everyone out there. Thanks for hanging out tonight. Brother Aleem is out of town, and he asked me to do the show for him, so I'm always happy, you know, as long as I'm, you know, not busy doing my own work, you know, to do and to cover for him, you know. And of course, if you heard last week's show with Sister Kadera, you know, she was doing her thing, so... Yeah, I just want everyone to just kind of just relax, you know what I mean? Just take it easy, let go of all the stress, let go of all the worry, let go, you know, of everything this matrix has put upon us. Just relax, breathe deeply. Taking those deep breaths from the spine, you know. Yeah. And just present here. Really, really happy to be here.
There must be some kind of way out of here. Said a joker to the thief. You know.
I'm excited to be here and to do this because I feel this is part of my life's purpose is helping out the people to the best of my ability and the things that I've learned along my journey to be able to help out. So tonight we're talking about the return of the renegade members of the Family of Light. Okay, so people may be wondering, who are the renegade members of the Family of Light? Okay. So basically, there's a book
that was written. This is a book that Aleem has suggested on his show before. He's read pages from it, or, you know, at least little sentences in here and there from it. It's a book written by Barbara Marciniak. Now, what she did is connect with this group of beings from the Pleiades star system. Now, when we say we're talking about the Pleiades, there's many different star systems. Like, if you heard of the shaman in Africa, I believe his name is, let me get it right. It is right at the tip of my tongue. I know it. He did like a 6-hour conversation. Credo Mutua. Okay. Yeah, Credo Mutua. And he talked about how beings came from Mars through light vehicles, or we talk about Merkabas. Human beings came from Mars, and as light vehicles manifested themselves upon planet Earth, and that's actually how we got here. Now, but there are many other star systems. And not necessarily every human comes from a star system. If you read a really good book, actually, I've been so busy the last couple months or so because I just been doing my work, man. I got to meet Dorian Virtue. If any of you people don't, if anybody doesn't know who that is, a very great, very intelligent lady who basically she was a clairvoyant as a child, and she basically was able to see other beings, talk to the angels, talk to the fairies, talk to, you know, whoever you name it, you know. And I was able to meet her, and she wrote an excellent book called Realms of the Earth Angels. Okay, so this is really just a different perspective to say that, yes, you're a human, or gods or goddesses, or, you know, whichever name you want to go by, but also we call earth angels. So there's different types of earth angels. There's incarnated angels, which are basically humans, but they incarnate as angels. And they have different characteristics about them that make them incarnated angels. And there's incarnated elementals, which are like people, but they're like fairies. Like Robin Williams is a good example of an incarnated elemental. Eddie Murphy is a good example of an incarnated elemental. There's the wizards. Those are the wise ones. Those are the people that every other word out their mouth is some form of mysticism. You know, they follow it to a T. There's mer people or mermaids. There's the Atlanteans. There's, you know, you name it. The Atlanteans. There's even some incarnated dolphin people, as they call them. So there's all types of people, but we all came here for the same purpose, to help basically make sure that this planet doesn't blow up. Because if this planet blew up, then it would defeat the purpose of coming here. In other words, we learn what we learn for our soul, and it's beautiful and great, but we would not leave the planet better off than when we came there. We would take some really great wisdom and knowledge with us, which is great for the evolution of our souls, but the planet, you know what I mean? The planet, and I know we all know, we should all know this by now, that Earth is one of the most difficult, harshest planets in the entire universe, in the entire galaxy. You hear Brother Panic talking about how much he doesn't, not that he hates Earth, but he wants to get up off of here. He wants to go. He wants to do his thing, you know. But you know why? Because it is one of the harshest, densest planets in the galaxy. And people are scared to come here, to incarnate here. I testify to that, you know. I understand now. I believe Brother Panic even talked one time and said that when he was contacting the Orishas, that he said that the scariest thing that they ever felt was becoming a human. Now, that's exactly what I'm talking about. This planet, and get me wrong, it's a beautiful planet, and it really doesn't really have anything to do with the planet. There's certain laws and certain things that makes this a constant merry-go-round. It's because this planet has duality. It has polarity, in which in the higher realms, you do not have this duality and this polarity. So for every good, there must be evil. For every good time, there must be a bad time. For every, you get the concept, it's constant yin and yang. So, I want to read a little bit from this book. You can actually take a class online. It's called Become a Realm Reader, and you can actually read people's realms, which is something that is just, to me, is awesome. Once you get the hang of this, you could just read people like that. It says, this person keeps making jokes and giggling a lot, and they want to party, and they, you know, they want to smoke, and they want to, you know, just get down and, you know, just have fun. Not saying that they are, but they have a chance of being, especially if they love to dance all the time, and if they're always giving you like this really, like, they can't really stop smiling. They have kind of like a twinkle in their eye, especially if they're always going at those chocolate almonds. That very well could be an incarnated elemental or a fairy or, you know. So I wanted to go here because tonight we are talking about the star people. So this is interesting. This is from the book. That Hollywood films and sensationalistic books portray extraterrestrials as vicious warmongers. Yet to ETs, and when we say extraterrestrial, Aline has broken down 1,000 times, extra, terra, astral. Just star energy. Earthlings are the ones who are violent. So violent, in fact, that many ETs were asked to take on human bodies to try to avert mass destruction. We call these benevolent helpers star people, or the singular star person. Thank God for star people. They came from physical and non-physical galaxies and took on earthly lives to spread kindness on an as-needed basis. Their collective niceness helps to diffuse the anger, stress, and rage that could lead to nuclear war. Destroyed, the negative effects will ripple through many galaxies. The star person's assignment then is to prevent nuclear war at any cost.
The main avenue for this lofty goal is through the expression of kindness, a common decency to others, a domino effect of sorts. On any given day, star people calmly smile as they perform unselfish deeds for those on their path. Those whom they help barely notice them, yet star people don't perform acts of service in order to gain accolades. Such deeds are an innate necessity to them, as if some sort of inner programming compels them to act. They aren't concerned that people rarely thank them. That's another thing that will get you really far. If you're not really doing this just so people can say, yo, man, you really deep. You got some points there, man. If you're really not doing it to get that or to seek approval, that would take you very far, man. Okay. So, not only is this the first earthly life for many star people, because this planet is so violent, emotionally and physically, star people often feel overwhelmed and wish to return home. After all, Earth is one of the most turbulent planets in the universe. And in fact, the universal powers have us quarantined so that we won't harm other planets. Earth is considered as dangerous as a teenager on steroids wielding a loaded gun. So, there you have it. So just to be here, just to accept this mission, just the fact that all of you are here tonight just shows how brave and courageous you were just to be on this planet. Since it would upset most people to receive intervention from ETs, no matter how benevolent they might be, these mighty and gentle beings elected to take human form and walk among us. So as we see, the ETs or star people, I mean, whichever name, you know, you want to call it, you know, as Aleem has said many times on his show, quantum physicists have now figured out that the human body is composed of stardust particles. And 10,000 or something stardust particles fall to the planet Earth daily by practicing Qigong cultivation, which is actually what I do. I'm a practitioner of Qigong, as well as Reiki, which means universal life force energy. By practicing these modalities and bringing this energy to you, you tap more into that which you were before you came here. There's many interesting stories that they talk about as far as this energy. I was going to read something here that's really interesting from a book that Aleem suggested. This was back in 2013, I think. Suggested that I get, and this was actually before I started taking this class. And says something that was really profound. That I really loved to read. Okay, so let's check this out. I have it right here. Da da da. I will find it. Basically, the whole concept of Reiki was basically people were wanting to figure out if Jesus, Yeshua, whichever name you want to give him, or Imhotep the Third, if he, well, we know that Imhotep III historically existed, but if Yeshua historically existed, which is arguable in that sense, because, you know, supposedly we don't have any physical evidence, but regardless, if it, basically people wanted to figure out how these healings were done, this hands-on healing, this, you know, how was it done? So in this book, Essential Reiki, A Complete Guide to an Ancient Healing Art by Diane Stein, she writes, the traditional Reiki story begins in the 1800s, but Reiki was ancient even then. Information before written records can be obtained only through channeling, and though material received in this way must be considered speculative, it is nonetheless interesting and thought-provoking. While unverifiable, the material is too fascinating to overlook, and I believe it to be highly valuable. In 1990, for my book, Dreaming the Past, Dreaming the Future, The Crossing Press, 1991, psychic Laurel Steinheist described the 12 source planets that were the original colonizers of the Earth. Most of these are located on the Pleiadian star system, with a few in the star systems of Sirius and Orion. People did not evolve on Earth. We were brought here from a variety of planetary cultures, and a number of channelers are now also describing them in their writing. A few scholarly translators of ancient documents are beginning to verify this as well, though at this time it still requires courage to do so. Okay. In 1991, I asked Laurel for channeling about the origins of Reiki. She described Reiki as having originated with a planet that also brought the many armed gods and goddesses to Earth, the root culture of what became pre-patriarchal India, the Indian god we know today as Shiva. Female at that time was responsible for bringing Reiki here, and she wants to be remembered for the gifts. When the human body for this planet was designed, Reiki was incorporated into the genetic coding as a birthright of all people. Reiki is a part of every one of us. It was once universal and was never meant to be lost. Children of early Earth in the civilization we call Mu today received Reiki 1 training at the beginning of grade school. They received Reiki 2 at what we define as junior high school age. Reiki 3, the teacher master's training, was required for educators and was available to any who wanted it. When in the 19th century, a Japanese man sought the origins of Jesus and the Buddha's method of healing. So, this is where this all comes from. This energy, according to this book and what I've read and what I understand, Reiki was a gift from the Pleiades. So, if anyone feels the calling, or just feels like they resonate with that particular star system, that energy is easily accessible to you, and you can do many things with it. I suggest for the people who resonate with the whole star person concept, that they study some form of energy healing, because I've noticed on my journey that seems to be something I'm not only very passionate about, but very good at doing and sensing and feeling that energy. So, and that energy, cosmic energy, can help you reach your search to, you know, if you're looking for enlightenment or you wish to speed up your spiritual, you know, whatever it is, the universal life force energy can help. It can reverse the aging process. it can add longevity. You can live up to, and Aleem always says it, you know, 120 years old, live up to, you know, the age of, you know, Methuselah, Ishmael, all these biblical characters that were living these really long ages. If you really want to stick around that long, it is possible. It is possible, you know. You can reverse the aging process. You can do all of these beautiful and wonderful things. So, as far as the Pleiades, they are beings that you could look at. It's not that they're at a higher level than us. It's just that they have, you could look at it like in grades. So say we've learned everything, we could be up in the fifth grade. Now, you could learn from somebody at the highest level. Are you going to, is a fifth grader going to understand someone that is at their PhD level? Or, you know, in that form and break down that, you know, are they going to be able to understand? You know, so you could look at it as the Pleiades are just one grade up above. So they remember being on Earth. They remember going through the trials and tribulations and challenges as a human. They remember the tests. So just like the ancestors, they remember what it's like, so they're very close. They're very close, just like the ancestors. They're just a little bit more evolved, you know. So you can contact them. And one of the things I didn't understand for a little while, because I was always like, I want to talk to my spirit guides. I want to talk to my spirit guides. I was wondering, like, what my spirit guides were, you know, and I never really thought my spirit guide could be an alien, you know. I was having a concept of knowing what it would be or just saying it has to be this way or that way when I had, you know, my guides at some of my ancestors. What I found out is that even a friend of mine, Indigo, she knows Aleem. She knows a lot of people on this network. And she told me, and she said that her spirit guide was this blue being, and she was kind of shy to kind of show herself, you know, because she just, you know, spirit guides aren't always, they're adjusting to the physicality of things. Anyways, she just said, so I, and then I just got the idea, oh, okay. So, you know, maybe it's not what I conceived it to be, but my spirit guides, maybe instead of thinking, you know, it's a fairy godmother or it's just an animal or whatever that I thought it would be. Now I got the idea. I was like, oh, okay. That would make sense. It would be extraterrestrial. But when we say extraterrestrial, we're saying something. We're not talking about a flying metal ship. These are just stereotypical ideas of what an extraterrestrial is. Extraterrestrials walk among us. We are them. Extraterrestrial just means something that's not on Earth. The sun is extraterrestrial. The moon, you know. So it's the same as above, so below. The supreme axiom. It's the same concept. And when you apply that, it just begins to register the as above, so below. So the Pleiadians, even though they may look like different than who we are, or they may, talk differently or whatever, they're still us. It's still the same thing. It's another version of yourself, or an ascended self, you want to say. As you move higher in the dimensions, you realize that the only thing that creates this duality and this distorted human version of thinking is on Earth. Once you begin to ascend into the higher dimensions, you realize that all is one. It doesn't even matter. It's the yin and the yang, and it's what they call the Tao. It's the eternal oneness. There is no duality. There is no separation. There is no nationality. There is just one. It's one love, one tribe. It's just one. Anyways, there are way more. There's way much more than Pleiadians. There's Sirians. There's what they call Draconians. There's different. Now, as far as the whole reptilian concept of things, I believe there was lies told by Zachariah Sitchin and different people. I don't know the dude personally, so I can't say. I'm just saying I believe that the whole reptilian concept, I do believe that there are beings that don't want this raise in consciousness. Not saying that they're necessarily reptilian, but regardless, I don't think it really matters, because the whole goal is to end this duality, not be stuck in this war and this constant dualism of things, because really the whole idea of enlightenment to me is, at least, is when you begin to see everything as just one. Yeah, so-and-so may preach about what Moses did and what so-and-so did 2,000 years ago, but if you look at, like, where did that concept come from? Someone told it to them, somebody pushed it on them, passed it down. They didn't learn, or they were never taught to really study and learn, so they passed that down. But it's really oneness, They just didn't know what they were doing, or thought they knew what they're doing, and gave it their best, But it's still one. I mean, all is one. Even the things that really irritate you about people, and I know it's hard. I know it's difficult. But nature gives everyone a job, I feel. And people that really irritate you teach you something about yourself. Otherwise, why? It could really depend. Sometimes someone is just being ignorant. And that's just what it is. But sometimes when someone really irritates you, I say, if I'm really comfortable with myself, I really have faith in myself, believe in myself, then how in the hell could something be really that, could someone really irritate me like that? If I'm confident, self-sufficient in myself, believe in myself 100%, then how could someone really get me off of my platform, How could someone take me out of my temple, But it happens. We are human. We make mistakes. That's part of it. No one is perfect. The person that is yelling that they're perfect obviously has a lot of learning, training to do. Because to me, enlightenment really just knowing how much you don't know. You have to empty your cup. You know, because if your cup is full and someone is, and, you know, you ever just, you know, you just meet somebody and you just know, or you feel like you know so much information, and you meet the person, and they're about to say something, and you just, you know, and, but your cup is full. So, as soon as you say all that to them, they begin to say what they feel inclined to say, and may be really helpful and beneficial to you, and a purpose for doing it, so a logic to it, you know, or no logic to it, you know. It, but your cup is full. You can't hear, really listen to what the other individual is saying. Because your cup is full. See, you can't listen or really feel from the heart what the other individual is saying. You know? And the ego is almost convincing you to say, like, no, you know everything. And you are everything. It doesn't mean you know everything. Because to know everything, when you are a part of the force, when you are a part of the source, to know every single thing is too much information, it's too much light. I don't want to say it's too much light, it's too much information, it's too much for the human body to process all that, having a human nervous system. Because everything that you examine, that you touch, taste, and smell, see, hear, you have to put into context the human nervous system. I forgot what his name was. Robert Ann Wilson. He was a dude that was really into studies like Aleister Crowley information. But not just that, he had his own style, you know, and he always was talking about that everything that you want to put into context, you have to put the human nervous system to perceive of it. In other words, if you try to get a newscaster and you're talking about how it felt to be on Mars, and the newscaster is just like talking about this reality, or the reality that he perceives to be in, we're talking about, well, this whole shit's happening here, and, well, what's going on Mars? And the person's not going to even, he's going to think you're just being silly. But if your human nervous system is actually perceiving the effects of being on Mars while you're talking to that person, then, in other words, it's not true reality, the reality that he or she perceives to be a correct view of reality, but is not reality in a sense. Because I said this the other day. I said, you know, we get so focused and we're in the car or we're driving or we're going somewhere or we're, you know, in the office, wherever we are, but we're so stuck in the house that all you got to do is look up at the sky or look at night into the stars and realize, yo, we're in space. That's the reality. Yeah, you're in a home. Yeah, you're in a house that has artificial lighting or has electricity and all that, and I'm not saying that is not necessary, but what I'm saying is we're in space, and I think a lot of us forget that. We are in space on a planet. On a planet. And there's many other planets. There's, I don't know, 44 billion something galaxies, to think that we are the only ones, it would be a silly statement, in my opinion, to make. There are other beings out there, you know. There are. And most of them, I would say, are in alignment with the ascension and the evolution of human beings. But there are also those who may not want that necessarily to happen. Sounds silly, but the mentality, the soul evolution that they come from, you know, is, I don't know, I'm not going to judge it, but I'm just saying we have to do what we do. And it's not really, I'm not going as an us against them mentality, but I'm just saying for people that are stuck in the Matrix, if they are really bringing you into that world of the Matrix and telling you this is what this is and this is the way it has to be, and everything that is right and exact, that you know you need to move away from that person, you know, unless, you know, say they've been your best friend for a long time. Now, I'm not saying anything against that, but what I'm saying is you cannot let others control your reality. All you have to do is study a little psychology, it will tell you this, but all that stuff that you talk about, the subconscious mind, the altar, and all that stuff, this is something that I didn't, it took me a while to realize. And then I had that aha, abracadabra moment when I realized how many advertisements were on the TV, how many things were set on TV, and how when something goes, it kind of sneaks under your conscious mind, it gets stored into the unconscious or subconscious mind. And those advertisements, in other words, if you didn't really know and you were just watching a commercial, and then 5-10 minutes later you start speaking about that commercial, that's how you know that a program has been put, downloaded into your mind. So, I'm not saying you can't watch the television, but the television, a good portion of stuff that is generated from the media, that is generated from Fox News, of course Fox News, of course Fox, pretty much in general, most stations are telling lies to your vision. Telling lies to your vision. And that creates a false reality. It gives you perceptions about the world. It gives you, there is so much mind control in the television. Don't get me wrong. There's shows I like to watch sometimes. But I'm saying a good portion of the shows, your perceptions are being made because of the television. You may not have originally been born and something is shown on the TV. And the typical view of what someone else thought about some person or someone or whatever it is, you see that on the TV, and then if you do not correct that, or you didn't catch it, some of your perceptions are being made just because of the television. Perceptions about the world, the way you think things are. The news, mainly, their concentration is focused on fear,
false evidence appearing real, fear is the main focus. Fear and whatever they can use to lack, to leech, extract an emotion from you, like in the movie Monsters, Inc., where they scare the children, or the children are sleeping, and then they capture it in this little jar and take it back to fuel their world. The emotions, the emotional reaction is what they are looking for, because that takes your energy. That takes your energy. In other words, you'd be sitting here doing Qigong, doing the hugging the tree, doing MT4s, raising your kundalini up, and feeling like Superman and shit, or Goku, or whoever you want to be, the avatar, and then you turn on TV and you see something that looks painful, that looks scary. You see something that says, because so-and-so did this, this is what happened to them. And all that training, that kundalini, that chakra stimulating, all of that stuff you were doing that made you feel powerful goes right out the window because you allowed it to capture your energy with the emotional reaction. That emotional reaction is what they look for. Because if you're scared, you are in a state of fight or flight, you have anxiety, you start racing and pacing, and then at that point, you're like, I need to find a pill, I need to find something from the pharmaceutical company to come and help whatever it is that they created in order so I can feel good and have a good night's sleep. Not everybody, but I'm saying there's a portion of people that you know that will do that. You see? And it's based on what they call the Hegelian dialect. And this is part of the mind control. Or as in the book Bringers of the Dawn by Barbara Marciniak, she calls frequency control, which is basically putting something out there, creating basically a problem. What they call the Hegelian dialect. So a problem, for every problem, it needs a solution. Let me see here. I'll find it. It was in a good lecture by Phil Valentine, where he was talking. Okay, here it is. Hegelian dialectic. Okay. Which is basically thesis, antithesis, synthesis, and I was copying this down from the lecture. So, but it is very true, and it really just clicked with me when I read it. Thesis, antithesis, synthesis, problem, reaction, solution. The Hegelian dialectic is formally defined as the process of change, whereby an ideation, which is the thesis, is transformed into its opposite, the antithesis, both combining to resolve to a higher form of the two, which is called a synthesis. It is based on the philosophy, the love of wisdom, of one George Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel, who developed it as an analytical tool for arriving at a mid-ground solution between opposing opinions. Okay? Okay, my bad. Okay, yeah, so
opposing opinion, this tool, and says a new science that came to be known as experimental psychology, a science pioneered by one Wilhelm Wundt. Warfare being used by the Vatican and government, it was later enhanced to become a weapon of psychological covert system of conquest in the late 19th to 20th century. It utilized the problem reaction solution formula, known as thesis, antithesis, synthesis, a process of analysis to arrive at a predetermined solution. Yes, the Hegelian dialectic is in fact a tool used for mass psychological manipulation and control. It works by creating manageable circumstances of chaos to orchestrate an outcome that was already calculated to manifest from the very beginning. So, the pharmaceutical company not saying all the hospitals, not saying all the doctors, saying Western medicine, but I'm saying there is a group of beings that like to play psychological games upon us, and as ridiculous and crazy as it sounds, we have to counteract it by not paying attention, by not giving our energy to beings that are nothing but takers. In other words, which they call psychic vampires. How you know you're around a psychic vampire? You will feel either drained, or there's always almost like a professional victim. In other words, the person can never really take responsibility for themselves. They're always looking for someone to make them feel good about themselves. There's nothing wrong. People should feel good about themselves. Sometimes people need help. But when you reach out for help and then you give an answer to what the person, you know, basically said, you give an answer, and then they go on talking about another problem, and then you give an answer. I was like, all right, you know, gave them about two answers or so, gave them some solutions. That should be okay. Then they go into another problem. Say, all right, you know what I mean? You'll figure it out. Okay, I'll help you out one more time. Then they ask again. It's like, hey, I've been giving you solutions. Everything's solution-based. How about I start doing the same thing to you? And then that's when they run off. You see, because everything should be a give and exchange. Give and exchange never creates the feeling of drainage. Because a give and exchange, which is currency, which is really what it's supposed to be, give and exchange, or an energy exchange. In other words, someone does a tarot card reading for me, I could give them Reiki in exchange, or I could give them an angel card reading, or I could, give them a Qigong class, or I could do some Reiki on them, or I could just help them out and give them advice, but there needs to be some form of exchange. As long as there's exchange, there's the flow. Like water is constantly going. It's what you could call a water relationship. Now, it was a Coca-Cola relationship, which I basically heard this concept from my man, Infinite Waters. Awesome brother. You should check him out. If you haven't, youtube.com/Infinite Waters. Dude is almost like he put together... He studies psychology, criminology, and other things, but he's an alchemist, he's a metaphysician, he's dude is just incredible. But anyways, he talks about the difference between a relationship and how water is a flow, the give and exchange. It's a constant feeling of balance. Versus a Coca-Cola relationship, you drink it, it tastes good in the beginning, but in the end, it's really not good for you. It's draining. So, an H2O relationship or some artificial flavor relationship? What's your flavor? You know? It's really what it comes down to. Now we got that under control. Frequency needs to be, if your frequency is high and you visualize yourself with a golden healing light, white light, golden light, pink, even pink light works. Visualize yourself helps you from the nonsense perpetrated. You know what I'm saying? If you turn on that television, you just happen to see Megyn Kelly, Bill O'Reilly, you name it. I'm not picking on anyone, but I'm just saying you're teaching bullshit to the people. You are not helping the people ascend. You are not giving them any form of evolution. You are not giving them anything that can help them evolve. You are not giving them any form of rising, of high regard within themselves. You are not teaching them to look within themselves to find their answers. You are not helping the truth. You are not helping people. You are not helping teach any form of metaphysics. Maybe that's not your job to do. Now, I'm just saying, you are not helping people feel better about African history. You are not helping people feel empowered. You are not helping the planet, period. All you are doing is spewing fear and control and ideas and preconceptions that existed a long time ago that don't even serve us today or help us ascend into higher beings in this day and time. My opinion, personally, I say let go of everything that does not serve you, that does not help you. There were things that you were programmed into, that programs could be from grandparents, could be from parents. If it doesn't serve your highest good in the ascension, yo, to let it go. You could call upon the energy of Archangel Michael. You could just say, Archangel Michael, I ask you to cut any cords that are draining my energy, that are not serving my highest good to be the most brilliant, advanced being that I could be, and to stay humble about it. Because humility is the path where you stay in the flow. Second, you start going with the, and you just start going preaching and says, well, I hit them with the funky rhythm and the wisdom and the metaphysics and the mysticism. And you start doing that. Now, the flow is fine, you know what I mean? But the whole thing is not understood unless there's humility. When there's humility, it's where you get to switch between the laughing child and the adult, or you could say the old man, because a child is humble, or you could be sometimes naive, but you're still playful and happy, he or she. And the wise the elder, happy and playful. Same thing. He still knows a lot, or he knows himself, or she knows herself, but the thing is she doesn't take herself so seriously. She doesn't have to prove, he or she doesn't have to prove anything to anyone because they're self-sufficient, self. They know thyself. So they don't need to prove anything to anyone because they know who they are. They know their life's purpose. They know their mission. They know what they're here to do. They know how to be of the greatest service to humanity. So that's what it is. You know? And so we all pretty much, I'd like to say, we all came here for a similar purpose. And we did, most of us. I'm not going to include Bill O'Reilly in that mix. I'm sorry. For those that like his show. But I'm just going to say, for everyone that wishes to ascend as a collective, that I'm saying, yes, we all, most of us. And see, some people say, well, you know, I don't really resonate with the whole indigo children thing, or I don't really resonate with the whole crystal thing, or I don't really look at it like this. I don't really like labels. I don't like titles. It's not about labels or titles. A title is once you've experienced something and you've gone through something, it makes you think otherwise. In other words, say, like, I was like, I don't care about Mercury in retrograde. I don't believe in Mercury in retrograde. Didn't matter whether I wanted to believe in it or not. Still got affected by it. Something that moves you to make you go, oh, okay. I resonated with the indigo concept. I was born into it. I was in second grade. This is not anything to say, this is nothing to feel pity for. This is everything to say that this is who I am. This is what I've become, who I am. And I wouldn't have it any other way. But being born, say, in the 90s, and having to be in second grade, having to have all the kids go into one little room, two buildings, and see this plane just drive into these buildings. To see that at a young age just showed me, you know, something's not right here. Something's not right here. This is supposed to be the home of the free and the land of the brave. I don't think so. Not after saying that shit. I was born into it, you know. I had a lot of teachers. Don't get me wrong. Some of them taught me some useful stuff. But a lot of teachers I was at odds with. And because I was the way that I was, you know, for the most part, I had good grades, you know. But if I didn't, for some part, because I didn't resonate with certain things. I didn't feel it was the truth. I don't feel that they focus that much on the Native Americans. I feel that there was a lot of lies. I feel that history was told by the victors. So, when you go against that and you go against what they want to teach in the curriculum, well, they just put your ass in detention. Or suspension, whatever you want to call it, when you go against the system, you know. But going against it to find the truth, I'm not going to be like these others here, the difference. So it's it really comes down to, you know, basically it's an inner knowing. And that inner knowing is basically the reason why you would resonate with certain titles, because you've gone through something or you've experienced something that makes you say, hey, you know, the whole Indigo thing, I was that dude, man. I was that dude. I was that little Neo. I was looking for Morpheus. I was that dude that said, you know, things are not supposed to be this way. I was that person that, I was that kid that when people said, I used to ask why. People would tell me to do things, or adults, so-called adults, would tell me to do things. And I said, you never ask why. So why not? He said, you just don't. It's disrespectful. Also, is it disrespectful to ask a question, question authority, question what I'm being told? Didn't hear much after that. I asked why. I needed answers. I needed the questions. Answers are out there, Neo. You'll find it. You look for it. You'll find it. The answers are out there, Neo. And I was that person that said, you know, I'm going to find these answers. I'm not going to become a fucking agent. I'm not going to become, you know, guys standing out there because I'm jealous of someone that's broken out of the matrix, that's broken out of the conditioning and this, you know, patriarchal system and this way of conditioning and a way of dressing and a way of having to do this and a way of having to do that. I'm not going to be jealous of someone and become someone that goes, Mr. Anderson, because I'm jealous of someone that is the one that has broken the confines of the matrix. In other words, that's me. And I had, you know, I mean, I had my intuition. I had, you know, my abilities. You know, I was able to, I'm able to see auras, you know, all these different things. But the Indigo to me was that person that said, I can't stand the lies. And I came here to change this shit. And it's got to be changed in one way or another. I'm not going to sit here and be docile about it. I'm going to be the person that it doesn't even matter if I'm at the restaurant and the person says, would you like water? And, you know, and they're doing their best to be polite. They may not even know about the fluoridation in the water. But I'm going to tell that person, is that distilled water? No, I'm going to say it in a polite voice. Is that distilled water? No, I'm sorry. Is that filtered water? We can check. No, I'm sorry. It's not tap water, is it? Yeah, it's tap water. Oh, okay, well, I don't want that. Thank you. Are you sure? You know? I'm not going to be that person that's going to be docile and sit and follow a lot of these things that the so-called Nazi scientist Adolf Hitler had to change the frequency of the music from 432 hertz, which is actually the natural frequency and rhythm, supposedly, that the instruments were tuned to. That is actually, if you listen to it, to me, it's a soothing, calming, beautiful sound. But actually, when you tune it to 440 hertz, which is the hertz that most of the music nowadays is played, it's actually a very fast-paced, beating, almost adrenaline, almost like a pacey fast food lane, snap your fingers type of hertz frequency to me. So a lot of these things, I'm not saying that Adolf Hitler was the culprit, but I'm saying the Nazi scientists, whoever it is, in fluoridation in the water, changed the frequency, messed with these things, did all these tests, studied behavioral modification study. I know I am in the same, I don't even want to call it a struggle because that doesn't even sound empowering. But I've been in the same boat. You know, but the thing is that that type of energy cannot get to the heart, cannot get to the love, cannot get to the higher states of being. I say this all the time, like the so-called Yahshua, if he existed in the 60s, you think he would have been out there basically saying, yo, you know, we're going over to Vietnam to, you know, participate in this war and all this. You think he would, where do you think he would have been? Be honest. Where do you think he would have been if he historically existed? Where do you think he would have been? In one place. Oh, yeah, probably say Israel, right? Or Egypt, maybe. Possibly. But I'm saying if he was in North America, where would he have been? Where's the only place to find some peace of mind to do the kind of thing, to love thy neighbor, to practically do these things? Where do you think you would have been? You're right. With the hippie movement. That's where he would have been. Because honestly, I tell you, that's where he is. Because that's the only place that was preaching that spreading that philosophy. The Maharishi, the Beatles, Jimi Hendrix, all that. Now, I wasn't there physically. You know, I don't know where I was. You know, but I'm saying, would have been on that fifth dimensional, that consciousness. You know, none of this war mentality, none of that. And we should realize after what I said earlier, we haven't realized already, that's one of the biggest things, is that we have to care for Mother Earth. Because this has nothing to do with Mother Earth and herself. Everything that she does, the frequencies, they call the Fibonacci numbers, the golden ratio. Everything has a certain sacred geometrical number. Everything almost, and if you mess with it, if you mess with it in nature and you made flowers and petals turned a certain way, that would actually intervene with the whole course. Just messing with one thing affects the whole. Has a ripple effect. Everything is divinely designed on Earth. Now, the things that were man-made and the laws that were man-made and the conditioning and the things that were taught and programmed, that has nothing to do with Mother Earth. That has to do with people and egos. But it has nothing. Mother Earth loves you. You could call her Pachamama, you could call her the goddess, you could call her whatever you want to call her, but she loves you unconditionally. And that's the truth. And that comes from the earth. The animals love you. You know what I mean? Not saying you have to go and try to hug a tiger, because I'm good, you know? But there was a time where we had animal communication, where we were able to telepathically talk to the animals and see what they understood. The animals love you. The animals are here to be your companions, you know. Even the insects. I'm still not down with the roach. I'm sorry. They just freak me out. All the beautiful things. Mother Earth grows things so you can understand her better. Ain't hating on the... Can't be hating because a plant grew this way, and just because you smoke it, it produces this sort of effect. And now it's the plant's fault. No, Mother Earth grows things so you can understand her better. The marijuana, the cannabis plant, has never done anything personally to you. In other words, people can say it's illegal or whatever. It is legal in some certain states in North America. But I'm just saying, can't be angry at a plant. You know, my mother, and she's from South America, from Venezuela, believe it or not, they had a play when she was younger, and she was the cocaine plant. This was the truth. But nobody heard anything was wrong about that plant. Nobody was using it and sniffing it or anything like that. It was just a plant. Just grew. And people thought it was a beautiful plant. It is. You know, but then when people start seeing, modifying it, trying to see what they could do with it, and they realize it gives them this effect, and after that, because it has that effect, then it can be made into a product. And after it's made into a product, it can be sold and sold and sold and this, and then people overindulge and call this. And then, who's to blame? The plant. But the plant has an intelligence. It's got nothing to do with the plant. It's the way you used it. You don't get to say, and God created every earth-bearing seed or tree-yielding seed, and then you get to rule out certain plants just because, you know. Now, you're talking about every seed. So ganja included. Now, there are certain effects. Trust me, nobody wants to lose their memory, of course. But there are certain effects. It's been even known to cure cancer. So you have to say that Mother Earth grows things so people can understand. The ayahuasca grows, and Native and tribal cultures knew this, and indigenous cultures knew this. Being able to grow these things, use these things for a purpose. Now, the medicine man, the medicine woman, use these particular herbs for a purpose. Not for recreational purposes to go watch Half-Baked or Hilden Kumar or something. And, you know, like, go to White Castle or something. You know what I mean? Not for that purpose. But for an experience, a spiritual experience, a vision quest, as some would say. So Mother Earth grows things to help you understand her better. If you want more information on that, you can read Keys to the Living Library, another teaching of the Pleiadians by Barbara Marciniak. Is an amazing book. I actually do not have that one. I just have Bringers of the Dawn, but I have, and you can actually get that if you don't have access to the book, which you can do is listen to it on YouTube for free. And, you know, you can listen to the whole book. Or if you got the book, you can follow along. You can listen. Teaching. Higher dimensional lights. Information. In that book, she breaks down. Light is information. I'll say it again. Light is information. So when you understand what Panic is talking about, he's always talking about light and all these certain things, and I'm wondering, are we talking about the light bulb? Or are we talking about lightning? Or are we talking about the spark within everyone's divine soul? That is actually what we're talking about. We're talking about information. Okay, so, Pleiades, members of the family of light, says, we rarely use the term God with the big G. Okay? Now, that's not saying that, not to use it. It's just saying they rarely used it. Because they're, what they're talking about, God is something that is far beyond a human experience. We're talking about a consciousness that is almost, if you've seen the motion picture, the first Star Trek movie, and it's interesting because I actually did this in a lucid dream one time. I was walking through this place, and I felt like the beings that were there did not want me to go into this particular place, but I went anyway, and I saw this consciousness, this electric energy source-looking thing, or, you know, ball look at this, almost like I looked in Star Trek. And I put my head through it, and I was like, and I was like, either it was too much for me, or I just downloaded all that information, or whatever. But you see the same thing in the Star Trek movie. And I had never seen this movie before I had this dream. So it's crazy. Basically, I did what I did in my dream. Then I saw the Star Trek movie, same thing that I did. I never even seen this movie before. Where did that come from? But anyways, we rarely use the term God with the big G. If we were to use that term, we would be referring to the entity we know as Prime Creator. Prime Creator, in its own personal implosion through love, endowed all things with consciousness. So we're talking about the Kundalini, the life force, the prana, the mana. The energy that created all of us.
Its energy surrounds us, binds us. Luminous beings are we, not this crude matter. You must feel the force around you.
We're talking about that same energy. All things are Prime Creator on Prime Creator's journey. That means, yes, brothers, and sisters, the animals, the fish, the dogs, the cats, the parrots, you know what I mean? The lizards, the baboons, all things are Prime Creator on Prime Creator's journey. Check this out. Next statement. The gods are here. You are these gods. Now, this is from the book. As you awaken your history, you will begin to open your ancient eyes. These are the eyes of Horus, which see not through the eyes of a human being, but from the point of view of a god. Oh, doesn't that sound lovely? So, these are what the Pleiadians are saying. Here's another from the book. Eliminate the words should and trying from your vocabulary. Now, it's interesting when you watch the Star Wars movie and Yoda's saying,
do or do not. There is no try.
And it's interesting that they say this, because it's very synchronized with this one. Because I, of course, heard the Yoda thing before. Should and trying from your vocabulary. Trying is not doing. Whenever you use the word trying, you will not accomplish anything, because trying is an excuse. In your own life, use the words, I am creating. I am doing. I am manifesting. I am intending. And I am bringing about. Forget. I am trying. When you become a doer and are able to manifest what you want in life, you set yourself up as a mirror around you. So, you set yourself as a mirror for people around you. Forget I'm Trump. Okay, so I know it's not necessarily easy to eliminate words from your vocabulary and say never to use them again. Not saying, you know, I mean, everybody, you know, may say it once in a while. I'm just saying eliminate it as best you can. Say I am intending, I am creating, I am keeping it popping. You know, I am intended. You know, I am superhuman. You know, whatever you want to call it, you know, but words of power that help manifest what you wish into reality. I tell you, these things, this information is beautiful. Just remember, there's a power. What they tell you in the Spider-Man movie. With great power comes great responsibility. So if you are truly, you know, the God, and you know, and that's what you call yourself, now that's beautiful. What I'm saying is, with great power comes responsibility. So there's more ability to respond to. That means it's all on you. Know? Really, you know what you're doing. Be mindful, you know, of your intention and your attention, because that is really what creates what you call reality, your reality. You know, a person, it's going to have a different reality. Someone who is playing World of Warcraft, you know, 24/7, than someone that is practicing Qigong or meditating, or, you know what I mean, a porn star. You know, they're going to have a different reality. Now, this should sound like common sense, but it's really true. They're going to have a different thinking, different elixirs in the brain, different brain chemistry going on. They may not understand what you're saying, because you're all in different worlds. Okay, so let's check this here. Something I was going to give. Da 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 da. Okay. This is what Dorian Virtue was talking about when she was talking about beings coming from all over the place to planet Earth. I'm saying coming in space pods. Crashing. Y'all seen that in Dragon Ball if you watch that show. Okay. It's just not this world. You are always going to feel in some shape or form like the ugly duckling. And part of the reason is because you are an alien on this planet. How many feel like you were dropped off on this planet and they just abandoned you? But that's the truth. You were dropped off on this planet. And it's very much like any of the Star Trek shows. You are a probe sent here.
Probe you are?
You are a probe sent here. You know what a probe is? They've got them on the moon. You're here on Earth, sending back signals back home. We all came from different places. So you may have came from Sirius, Orion, Pleiades, Draco, Arcturian, Arcturus. The list goes on and on. You may have came from the angelic realm. You may have come from the elemental, the fairy realm. You may have come from the wise ones. You know, you've been on this planet a long time studying sorcery, divination, a magician, magi. You know, you could be a merperson, a merman or a merwoman. You know, you could come from the dolphin realm. You could come from the leprechaun. You could come from what they call the knights and the paladins. You could come from the genie, the Aladdin realm. There's many realms. You could come from the Atlantean realm. So there's many realms. But we all came from different places. But we all came here for the same purpose, to save humanity and this planet. Like in the Matrix. You know, it goes through that whole thing. And then Cypher says, you know, but how do you really know you're the one? Because I don't know. You know, and it's just a feeling, and then, you know, and then something like that. And then Cypher goes, so you're here to save the world. Jeez. What do you say to something like that? And that's truthful. Be point, honest. Not talking about careers, not talking about what you use to make for money, but on a global purpose, we are here to save the planet. You know, if any of y'all watch Dragon Ball GT, you know, it says, in the theme song, it goes, calling the greatest warriors in the universe in all the worlds. And that's really what we are. Now, we talk about a warrior, we're not talking about, you know, someone that has to carry a weapon, sword, or, you know, whatever. We're talking about someone who's courageous in their work and what they do. And they love for it, and they heal with it, and they use their powers for a higher purpose. What they say in that Star Wars movie, I believe it was A New Hope. Return of the Jedi, was it the last one? I believe it was the fifth Star Wars. It says, Vader, you could strike me. If you strike me now, I will become a more powerful Jedi than you will ever imagine. In other words, forget going on this path just because Vader had some power with the dark side for a little while because he was tapping into his subconscious and unconscious and forgot who he was and dealing with, you know, the dark side of the Force. Which, not saying anything wrong against that, but what Obi-Wan was saying is that it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you've learned in the dark side or the light side. It doesn't matter. You strike me, I will become a more powerful Jedi than you will ever imagine. It's not even about power. It's just because he worked with the light. He worked with the Force so much, the light and darkness. He fought Darth Vader. But supposedly he lost. Well, he didn't lose. He just got struck with a lightsaber and he just disappeared. But because it's not even about being, it's not even about fighting for a cause. It's about transcending, going beyond all that. Where you can see from the eyes of God. If you strike me, I will become a more powerful Jedi than you could ever imagine. In other words, the Jedi Code. Fighting for that higher cause because he was one with the Source. And they even say that in the Matrix movie. That you can either, you know, be deleted or, you know, as a sentient program or whatever you want to do or return to the Source. We are all here to do what we are all here to do. But it's the Source. We talk about the Source. I'm talking about the Chi. I'm talking about the universal life force energy. I'm talking about not saying anything greater than yourself or outside of yourself. I'm talking about your higher self, the spark within you. As you read and you know, and you read and understand what the angels are, and the angels see beyond human error and mistakes. They do not see what you see. They do not laugh at you. They do not judge you for the way that you think. Or if you call someone stupid ass or whatever, they do not at that. They focus on the true light and love that you were created with. And that is all that they see. You cannot focus their vision into something any less than that. They are true extensions of the higher source, higher self energy, God or goddess energy, or prime creator, or whatever you want to call it. That is what they are. So this is a by far intelligent design, just as the pyramids were a by far a very intelligent design. Beyond intelligence, you could say. But that same divine inspiration and intelligence that's put in the pyramids is the same divine spark put within you. And you didn't have to carry blocks, you know, create. And no one to this day, you know, can build a pyramid. So don't get me wrong, at least not with, you know, we have access to 100% of our brain or something, you know, but what I'm saying is the human body, the mysteries within it, it's all divinely orchestrated. The divine, the source, Ra, Osiris, Cyrus, or Isis, or whatever name you want to call it, really doesn't matter. It's all talking about pretty much the same story. The names may change. The all pretty much the same story. It's a story that somebody had. They wanted to give a good... a good symbolic representation of the life experience. That's pretty much what it is. Sometimes it's after the life experience, you know. But there's so much more. So much more than, you know, what you think you are. You know, this is a really self-help show, but what I'm saying is, if you're on the path to your life's purpose, doing your best to raise the consciousness, expand humanity, have love, you know what I mean, for all humanity, do your best not to get caught in the dualism and the duality. You are on your path. Which thing is, you are on this path since you came into this world in that space pod or wherever you came in. But the thing is, you forget about it because you go through a little amnesia. And this amnesia is what blocks truth, story of who you are, how you came here. Some people have better access to the memories than others, or they just remember better. Some people completely forgot. Some people can't even remember what they did last week. You know, so just be grateful for what you know, what you have. You know, you can reverse the process, but I'm just saying, you know, it's be grateful for what you remember. It truly is beautiful. I would say I am really happy to be here and to do this for my brother Aleem and Kadera, because I really do appreciate them, and they've taught me so much. And I'm only of 20 years in this physical existence, but I feel like I've done my best to add on, you know. I do my best to love all of humanity. Let's keep the pineal glands flowing, though, you know what I mean? But, you know, let's keep the pineal gland popping. You know, we need that. That is our connection to mothership, you know, at this time. You know, I do my best being to come off as a heretic to anyone. I do have appreciation for all world religions. I just feel that there's a lot of lies and manipulation that were told to the people, and that also that things that worked or were so told 2,000 years ago, you know, how can we practically apply them in 2014? If it works, then it works. You know? I watched this video that said this guy, that if you actually send Reiki to a cup of water for 8 hours, supposedly the water will turn pink. Now, that's the closest thing to some water and to some wine shit, you know. But what I'm saying is there's a possibility, you know, it can happen, you know. You know, I mean, we just really got to be, so that's all I'm saying. I do my best as far as realizing the truth in all, you know, the holy books, You know, but I'm a lover of the truth, and I'm going to go wherever the truth guides me. You know what I'm saying? So that's where I'm going to be. You know, if it was Imhotep III, and that's the true historical Yeshua everyone's looking at, then that's, you know what I'm saying? That's who it was, and that's who the energy and the appreciation, the admiration needs to go to. Right now, there is no physical evidence, but I want to say it's not anything towards any religion. I just am not for any form of lies, trickery, or manipulation towards anyone, and it's not, and that does not benefit, you know, humanity as a whole, you know, in the collective. And the beings that wish to ascend and get on board with this ascension process, you know, it's ongoing. You know, that's all I'm saying, you know. You know what I mean? It ain't hard. Just, you know. Keep the pineal gland flowing. Keep everything flowing. Keep it moving. Don't let that, you know what I'm saying? If your pineal gland, if you feel like you've gotten some fluoridated water or whatever, you know, you can drink some apple cider vinegar. And that can just clear it up like that. You can get the panic pack. You can, you know, from broke panic, you can get whatever it is, you know, that you feel inclined in your personal path. You know, I mean, you can be anything, but there are people that I feel there's more so people that have the energy blueprint of a healer. There's more people that more inclined to more occult and magician forms. You know, it's up to you. You know, you just got to experiment and figure out, you know, what works best for you. That's the thing. Like Bruce Lee said, I cannot teach you, only help you explore yourself. So, with your genetic structure, with your mind, with your body and spirit, I can only help you explore what is most conducive to that which is within you. I appreciate you guys so much for coming out here tonight. Peace and love. Thank you for having me here, doing my best as a star person, being, pleading, whatever you want to call me, indigo, you know what I'm saying? Yoda, you know, do my best to live the light, spread the light, and help empower and help everyone in the ascension process. So I want to say thank you so much for coming out here, and give yourself a round of applause for listening. If you listen through all that shit, then hopefully you will find some things in there that make you question or make you think a little and go, or maybe you disagree or whatever it is, you know. But I hope that I helped some shape, form, or fashion. I appreciate and I love you all. Thanks. Let me be here. It's an honor. Peace.